Welcome to the NIO Student Dear Learners. Today we have gathered for this another session which is talking about tools and techniques of evaluation in work education. So we are going to discuss tools and techniques of different evaluation techniques with specific reference to work education. Let me just introduce myself. I am Dr. Sonal Chhabra and we are going to deal further with this topic where we are going to understand the different tools and techniques which we use in evaluation when it comes to work education. Now, the nature of the subject is very different from the other subjects. If we talk about the science, if we talk about social science or mathematics and work education, the work education is having a very different kind of nature. So, it's not just about the kind of methods which are going to be used, even the kind of assessment methods which are going to be used for these three subjects are going to be varying in nature. We need to really understand that what is the basic behind the work education. Now, we all know that work education is something which is not just talking about the theoretical knowledge or the practical knowledge. It's also talking about the different values which we need to develop or which we need to develop among the learners, the different kind of skill sets the students need to develop, the different kind of attitudes the students need to develop. So, since the objectives are different and the objectives is not just the cognitive gains, the objectives are the psychomotor gains and the affective gains also. So, accordingly, my assessment pattern is also going to be different. Now, when we talk about the fundamental methods of assessment which are used in the work education, there are different four methods which are popular. The one form is the individual assessment in which an individual is being assessed, as the name gets it clear. The second is the group assessment. The third is the peer assessment and fourth is the self assessment. Now, what is happening in peer assessment? That the other peers of that particular learner are assessing that particular learner. Self assessment, I am assessing myself as a learner. I means here a learner only. A student is going to assess himself or herself as a learner, that how far he is going to be good in that particular setting. Now, similarly, group assessment, assessment which is happening in a group, that how that particular child is behaving in a group situation. So, individual assessment is there, group assessment is there, peer assessment is there, and the self assessment is there. Now, these are four fundamental methods. Now, there are different tools and techniques which accompany or which accomplished under these four methods. These different methods are observation, interview, checklist, cumulative records, lecture, group work, examination, question forum, debates, rating scales, questionnaires, photos and portfolios, the project work, the competition, the assignment work. Now, from this one slide, you understand that there is a plethora of the different tools and techniques which can be used in assessment. But we need to understand which kind of technique or which kind of tool I am going to use in a particular kind of setting. That would again depend on the kind of objective which I have, the kind of curriculum which I am going to assess, the kind of learner whom I am going to assess would definitely make an impact the kind of technique I am going to use. Now, we are going to discuss some of those important ones which make an impact or which form the basis of the other techniques also. Let's just talk about observation. Now, observation is something which can be used as a method for work education also, but observation is something which is a popular assessment method also. The child should be observed in the natural environment. Now, this observation can be done individually also or in a group also. I mean, I have given an activity to a child or learner in a classroom setting and I see how the child works on that activity. Now, if I do it this way, then the observation is done individually. But if I have made the child to work in a group and then I am observing the child or the learner, then the observation is happening in a group. So, observation can happen individually also and observation can happen in a group also. Also further, you can know about the different behavior, the interest and the challenges of the students when you are observing the child. Now, this observation may be accompanied by a checklist also, or there may be a rating scale also which can help you in doing that also, or there may be a column of remarks also, or you may be making some kind of anecdotal records also. But primarily, observation is the technique which you are using when you are using a checklist or a rating scale or any of these kind of things. So, here the focus is not just again understand the procedure or the process which the child is following through when he or she is engaged in a particular work education activity. Here the focus is also on the behavior the child exhibits, the interest the child shows in different kind of activities and the challenges of the students. Now, observation also equips you with that kind of thing, wherein you are able to understand the different kind of challenges the students face or the learners face when they are doing a particular activity. Now, that's about observation, that how observation works as an assessment tool. Second is the interview. Now, this is one word which we all have heard in some of the other form. You may have gone for a placement interview or for a job interview. But interview is another technique which can be used for assessment in work education also. Now, what is happening here is that it's an important method of knowing the behavior, the attitude, the aspirations, the problems, and the achievement of the learners. So, if we understand from this definition or if we go by this principle, then we would see that it's more or less an individual kind of activity which would be happening. So, you may have a set of questions ready with yourself and you are interviewing the child or interviewing the learners one by one individually. So, you are asking them the questions and they are giving you the answers and you are making a note of the answers and then trying to assess how the child is behaving. So, here the assessment is of the behavior, the attitude, the achievements as discussed earlier, the aspirations, the problems. Now, just understand that here we are doing an assessment of the child rather than an evaluation of the child. So, we are not focusing on how many marks he is going to score or how good he has done. We are just trying to understand how does he behave, the kind of attitudes he has, the kind of aspirations he has. Now, if I know as a teacher the kind of aspirations my learner has or my learners have, then that would determine the kind of method which I am going to employ the next time when I am going to engage in a work education classroom. So, it gets affected by all those things, that how my class is going to move further after this kind of assessment which I have carried out. Similarly, the interview method, you need to make a preparation for an interview in advance and question and objectives should be identified. And as is clear with any other method, it's going to happen with that interview technique also, that if you have your objectives laid down, if you have your objectives which are clear in your mind that I need to accomplish this or I want to or I intend to achieve these objectives, then I would plan my interview accordingly. Then I would plan my questions accordingly. It shouldn't happen like today morning I went to the classroom and I decided that I'm going to assess my children's achievements through an interview method. Now, what is going to happen in this kind of setting is that you haven't thought about it beforehand. Since you haven't thought about it, there are chances that you're going to miss certain important aspects in your interview. But if you plan it, if you think about it in advance, if you frame down the questions, you are going to be in a better position to identify the aspirations and the challenges which the students are facing. Similarly, for the children, their friends and their parents can also be interviewed. I discussed earlier in this technique that we can interview the child, but we can interview the parents also, or we can interview their peers also and try to understand the kind of behavior the child is exhibiting or the kind of attitude the child is showing. Now, you have given a work education activity in your classroom, you have discussed about it and you have laid down the procedure, demonstration, everything has been done in the classroom and then you have given a home task to be done. Now, here needs to be seen that how does the child do the task at home? Does he take that kind of interest or is he taking help from others to finish those tasks? Now, this can be known only if you move to the parents and then you interview them and then see that how do they tell you about that particular child. Now, this is about interview as a technique. Let's move further and try to understand the role the checklist plays in assessment. Now, checklist is a kind of list which you have made with yourself and there are certain items written on one side and you do an observation and see whether they are exhibiting those behaviors or those items or not, or you're making a yes-no kind of thing. But if you do just this kind of effort that you're making just the yes-no kind of thing, it's going to be giving you limited knowledge or limited understanding of the child. But if that column of yes, no is also followed by a column of remarks, wherein you have that subjectivity also and you can write those remarks also systematically about any kind of activity or the behavior, then that is called the checklist. Now, remarks recorded systematically about an activity or behavior are called checklist. Now, here what is happening is that you will draw the attention towards a particular aspect of the child's personality, because you are making remarks about each and every activity which the child is engaging in. And if you find something specific about one particular aspect of the child's personality, the checklist would help you in doing that. So checklist can be used easily, they can be used very quickly, but only if you have thought about it in advance and if you made a, you have devoted a specific amount of time to develop that checklist also nicely. You would have thought of all the activities or items which you want in that checklist. You would have thought about the yes-no kind of scaling you want. And you have given a specific portion about the remarks also. And then when are you engaging in this kind of assessment? Maybe it's during an activity or maybe once you are done with the activity and you are having that reflection time with yourself, the students are engaging in something else. Then also you can use that checklist also. So it really depends on how the teacher is going about it. If the teacher is just using it for the sake of using it during the class activity only, it's going to yield different kind of results. But if the teacher is giving it a thoughtful ear, thoughtful time while preparing that checklist also and while filling that checklist also, it's going to give a different kind of result. But checklist is an essential part and it's an essential assessment technique which we all need to acknowledge and appreciate also. Now, these remarks help to know about the reactions and answers of the students. Now, since we are saying that we are giving a column of remarks, that's going to give you an edge as a teacher because you're going to understand the specific behaviors which are there and the specific reactions which the child would have given or the specific answers which the child would have given, the learners would have given in a particular setting. Interview, observation, checklist. The fourth one which comes down in our list is the cumulative records. Now, what is cumulative records? As pretty clear from the name, it's a descriptive record of an important event. Whatever important, see, you cannot record down everything which is happening in the child's life in the, your classroom. So, what you are doing is, you are making a descriptive record of the important events happening in the life of the children. So, you have done several activities and several work education classes with them, but you have made specific records about certain events which have happened with the particular child in your classroom. Let's say maybe a child enjoyed a particular activity in a very glad manner, or probably the child exhibited good communication skills, and then you need to see ki what kind of settings were there when that particular child exhibited that kind of behavior. So there is the descriptive record. So it's just not that the points have been written. You write down the whole situation, the whole occurrences, the whole events which are happening in the life of the children. As clear, it's a method or it's a technique or it's a tool, whatever you want to call it. It's something which is based on observation. So, if you have good observation skills and you have sensitivity to see the kind of behavior the children are exhibiting in a particular setting, you will be able to maintain good cumulative records. Also, they can prove to be a work at a larger scale. Now, it really depends that how you use the cumulative records, because if you understand, since if your class has 30-40 children and you make cumulative records for all the children, then it's going to have a work of a larger scale. I mean, it's not something which can be easily done in a day-to-day activity. So, the teacher would have to make choices that what does she want to engage in? Does she want to maintain cumulative records for all the events, or does she want to record only certain important events? Now, does she want that one particular event should be recorded for all the children, or she can make records only of those events which are particularly different for one particular learner or for particular learners? So it really depends on the children, in the teacher's mindset also, or the teacher's priorities also, or the teachers, how teachers look at those kind of things also. Similarly, there is this method questionnaire which is there. It's pretty similar to interview, but the only difference which is a very big difference is that in interview there's this face-to-face thing which is happening, an oral thing is happening. Now, in a questionnaire, what is happening? That there is a list of questions which is completed by the students or by the teachers for that particular student. So, here it's a written kind of thing which is happening. A set of questions has been prepared, it's printed or handwritten on a piece of paper and handed over to the student to be filled by the student himself or herself or by the teachers also for that particular child or for that particular activity. Now, through this, the responses about the student about a particular subject are recorded, and it can be done easily in a group also and individual settings also. So now that's a big advantage of questionnaire, because that saves a lot of time. Now, if you're doing, let's say if you have developed a set of 10 questions for an interview, and if you have 30 children in your classroom, and if an interview takes 10 minutes per child also, so 30 into 10, you know that you need at least 300 minutes for yourself. Now, what is happening in a questionnaire, the same set of 10 questions can be there, and since you can do it in a group, you can hand it over the printouts to the children and then ask them to fill down. In 10 minutes, you can have that answers to 30 students or responses from 30 students. So it's giving you a good amount of information on a larger scale. But yes, then that would make a difference on the kind of information you're going to get. So it really depends. It should depend on, rather than saying that it depends, it should depend on the kind of information I intend to collect from the students as a teacher. If I'm having a feedback about myself as a teacher, or probably a feedback about a particular work education activity, probably the questionnaire is one of the best possible methods or best possible techniques which can be used. However, if there is this situation wherein I intend to know the kind of experience the child had, the kind of challenges the students are facing in a particular setting or particular social environment, then probably the interview method is going to work better. So depending on my objective, my assessment technique would get differed or would get varied. Following in the same list, there is another particular method which is used for assessment, is the either the photographs or the portfolio which we maintain for the students in the classrooms. Now, this is one technique which has been recently been very popularly being used, especially with the primary children, that the teachers would maintain a portfolio wherein they are putting a collection of whatever work the students have done in a certain format, probably a certain duration, probably over the year, over the kind of work the child has done. And there are schools then who would engage in exhibiting those products also. So now what is happening in a portfolio? There is this one, probably a folder kind of thing is maintained for the one particular learner, and all the work which has been done by that particular learner over this over the quarter or over the year is being recorded or is being put into that portfolio. Now what happens at the end of the year, that gives a sense of accomplishment to the child also, that okay, I have done this kind of work. And the teacher is also able to understand the child better, the kind of development would have happened in the chronological way in the child. I mean, the child would have been 10 years of age when the child would have started with work education classes with you. And by the time he covers that academic year, he's 11. And then you see the kind of the records which are available about the chronological development also, that how he was behaving as a 10-year-old or how he painted as an 11-year-old. So that's the kind of intention behind maintaining portfolios or photographs of the children. Further, they are an accurate proof. If we talk it very practically, they are an accurate proof of the development of the student by just glancing at the work of any 2 months in a year. I may not need to look at whatever the child has done throughout the year. I may just look at 2 months and see how the child has been doing. So they are an accurate proof because that's something which the child has done. So through this, the students also get to an opportunity that they observe what they have done. Now, we talked about the self-assessment as one of those four fundamental methods of assessment in work education. So this may prove as an assessment of self when the child is looking at whatever the child has done over the year. So they are able to observe their own progress also, that how I have improved myself. Now, once you realize that these are the areas which I need to improve on and these are the areas where I've done pretty good, so I make an assessment of my own self. This was about the photographs and the portfolios, another P method, which is also the project work which we give to the children. Now, what is happening in the project work is that it's given to the students individually or probably in a group for achieving specific goals. Now, it's aligned to the kind of method which we use method of teaching learning which we use in work education. We can use that project method as a method of teaching learning also, and we can use the same project work as a tool of assessment also. So what is happening here? It's given to the students individually or in a group for achieving that specific goals. You have laid down objectives for yourself, you have laid down goals for yourself, and in that you are seeing that how does the student performs. It provides you opportunity for doing researches, collecting the data, analyzing, explanation and generalization. So it's not just about doing those particular activity, it's about collecting data also, it's about how do you analyze that particular data, how do you explain and how do you understand from that data or how do you generalize from that data. So it works well when you're working in a community or when you're working in a social environment. The children are able to learn better, they are able to connect the class with the life, whatever they have been doing theoretically in the classroom and what they are seeing or observing in the life. So they are able to establish those connects also of a class with life and then learning from each other also. So it's not just limited to that I am doing a particular activity, I'm learning from each other also. When you're working in a community setting or when you're working on a project method, you realize that you learn from each other also. Because as we said earlier, it works well when it is done in a group. It can be done individually, there is no dearth about it, but it works well when you do it in a group. And then you, once you do an activity in a group, there is this advantage that you are going to work in a group and you're going to learn from each other also. So project method would work well if the students know about it, if the students have that specific set goals about it, and they are provided opportunities for doing those kind of things. So let's just have an understanding of the different kind of tools and techniques which we have been talking about, or we have been talking about the kind of activities or tools or techniques which we can use in assessment. Number one was observation, which we discussed, interviews we have discussed, checklist we have discussed, cumulative records we have discussed. Then there can be group work, and you can make an observation of the kind of group work which the child is doing, the kind of behavior the child is showing in a group work. There would be children who would be better at things when they are doing the things individually, but there would be children who would be better at things when they are doing it in a group. So that would help you to list down those behavior skills also, or behavior sets of the children also, when they work in a group and when they work individually also. Then there can be examination, there can be question forums, there can be debates on these issues. You have taken up a socially charged topic and you are talking, you are having a debate on the same. Let's talk about the importance of health, let's talk about the importance of hygiene in our setting and the kind of social response we are getting to maintain that hygiene in general day-to-day life also. So you can have a debate also, and then you can gather different kind of viewpoints also on the same. Rating scales is another popular thing which is used for or as a technique of assessment, because what happens here, how it is different from a checklist is, checklist gives you an option of only of yes, no and then remarks. What rating scale does is, probably on a particular item, you can rate the child from 1 to 5. That means if the child is exhibiting very good behavior, the child may get a rating of 5. If it's lesser than that, then it's 4, 3, 2, 1. So on that same behavior, you can rate the child and you can see that how the child is progressing over time. Then questionnaires are there which can be used individually also and which can be used in a group also. And we have already discussed that in a questionnaire, you can save a lot of time in collecting the data. I mean, over a small amount of time, you can collect a large amount of data. Large means from a large number of children, so large number of learners. So that's the advantage of questionnaire method. Then we talked about the photos and the portfolios, which have this advantage that they are the accurate proof of whatever is happening in the classroom and how the child has progressed over the years. Then there is project work, then there is competitions which are being organized in the classrooms. There are competitions which are organized and which can work as a technique of assessment. Then there is the assignment work which is being given to the children in normal classrooms also, or probably to be done at home also. So these are the different tools and techniques of assessment which the teacher can engage in when the teacher wants to ascertain how the children are working in a particular work education classroom. But they would be determined again by how the teacher is looking at work education. If the teacher is having that idea in mind that it's going to imbibe certain kind of skills or it is going to develop certain kind of values among the children, then my assessment technique is going to be in that manner only. But let's say if I am focusing on that way that it's just a time filling activity which is happening, then my assessment technique is going to get varied by that. So we all need to understand that when it comes to work education, since the subject is different, since it is going to have a different curriculum, since the teaching learning methods are going to be different, so there has to be different methods of assessment, and the teacher needs to provide opportunity or take out time that different kinds of methods of assessment are actually used in the classroom, because that's going to aid not just the teacher to understand the children, but also the teacher would gain from understanding that how good she did in the classroom. So it's going to provide a kind of feedback to the teacher also. Now that's all about tools and techniques of assessment when it comes to work education classrooms. I hope you had a nice session about the same. Thank you.